Jordan said that he's subscribing to whatever Jenna's on, and Pat, you posited that this was pills, correct?
Well, no more pills on the island. They go through your suitcases. That being said,
okay,
Jenna's probably on pills.
Welcome to another brand spanking new episode of another Bachelor podcast. My name's Dylan. I'm saddled up next to one real Nicholas Davis.
What's going on, everybody?
And then the guy behind the glass, our faithful producer, Patrick.
Hi, everybody. And this is our second episode of the week, and I don't want to hear any of you bitchy baby birds out there complaining about it showing up late. It's here. Shut the fuck up.
Great way to start things off.
We give it to him in a slow drip.
Guys, let's just jump right into it. Not the episode. I mean general thoughts.
This show would be much better if Tia and Colton weren't on it.
I disagree. Nick?
There were some slow parts. There were some really entertaining parts. And I would just love to find a relationship where I had as much passion as Jordan and Jenna.
Great take. I thought it was a fine episode. The weakest of the three that we've been offered, but still a fun time. Guys, Colton and Tia came to Paradise. Relationship status? Complicated. And then Becca walked in, and now Colton is in a tailspin. Guys, I mean, this is a bullshit conversation, huh? But let's get into it.
Chris Harrison's just fallen in love with the term tailspin. He used it on Blake. He used it on Colton.
I want to preface that. I don't want to end up in errors and omissions, which we haven't done in ages.
We do continue to omit it, ironically
enough. We
have
a couple of errors and omissions to put into this week's errors and omissions.
To be fair, last episode's errors and omissions segment was going to be that we had no errors and omissions on our Bachelor in Paradise premiere recap episode because it was a perfect podcast. It was the best hour of pod we've ever laid down.
Anyone's ever heard.
The few hundred thousand of you out there that are listening to this are privileged to have been a part of that.
But anyways, we'll get to errors and omissions later. Okay, we were watching this and I was confused about, or rather worried about what we were going to talk about. Because I saw Nick's Microsoft Word tab open. That cursor just sat blinking in the top left the entire time. It's a weird conversation because I feel like she knows that he's a bigger douchebag than we think he is. She says that Garrett line at the end. She's kind of just throwing shade at him like, hey, I'll tell Garrett you say hi. But jumping right to the end of the conversation, which isn't good hosting.
Please do. There wasn't a lot said. I don't know.
No, there's some stuff said.
I got a fucking clip. Can I play the clip?
Yes, play the clip.
But I do appreciate you giving me that closure that I think I was looking for.
Take it or run with it.
I honestly, I'm going to try to give it my all and be all in with it all.
Do that then. I have all the faith that you will.
We were all waiting for this. I mean, he really needed this kind of really deep, substantial closure with a person who's been in his life for such a long time.
Here's a fun question. Do we think Colton cries again this season?
Absolutely.
I hope not, because I think that might start working to his detriment.
Why do you ask?
Just because it's kind of been a theme with him, well, but now that he's had this closure, is he at peace, or is he still a fragile man?
Yeah, his shackles, are they shattered? No. She says, I think that you should express your emotion like you're doing now with all the other girls, which is terrible advice. And then he says that he's good and that he's going to give it his all to be all in with it all.
There's a theme here with BIP, which is within seconds, your entire emotional energy and vibe can change.
Things change quick.
Quick. It's almost unbelievable.
Yeah, well,
to do with the tide.
Let's move on away from this yucky, boring conversation between the worst bachelorette in history, and Colton to the beach where everybody's hanging out.
A lot of guys talking shit except for Grocer Joe.
Right. Grocer Joe is kind of above all of it because he's a simpleton. Let me say, they're all very calm hanging out, and Bibiana says, when things are this good, you know something's coming.
These people are so nihilistic. It's like every episode of Entourage, something bad has to happen.
Yeah, it's almost like they've been conditioned.
Bibiana is also a producer's dog there. They're using her for voiceover as a narrative. And if yes. you caught it, Bibiana basically sets the stage for what's happening in this episode and what took place. We want me to do a little roll call of what she did?
Whoa, I'm really throwing
relationships up. Happening. Roll call! Right now at the start of the episode, we have Annalise and Jordan, we have Kevin and Astrid, and we have Joe and Kendall.
I love the take that she's the muse of this show right now, because she's not falling in love with anybody. I mean, she's just sitting there on the sideline. But let's get to all those couples. Annalise says that she respects Jordan. And also that she knows Jordan is going to be a good husband. Wow. That's a lot, huh?
And the other girls were looking at her just like we were.
Like, what's wrong with your face?
And this isn't going to end well. And that's a weak, weak jaw.
Right. Right.
It looks like an avocado that sat on the table a little too long.
You mean the entire head?
Yeah, yeah.
The funny thing about overripe avocados when they turn brown, though, the taste isn't that great. The thick, fatty texture remains.
Is that right?
You know, Nick is from a gross place of the country, so even filthy, rotten brown avocados, they're still such a luxury to him. He'll still just bite it like an apple.
Dylan here gave me my first avocado.
You know what? I can think back so fondly to that day when Nick took a steak knife, because that's all we have here at the office, and he cut the avocado like a mango, like an absolute idiot.
I was chastised then just like I was here today.
Yeah.
That Reno whore, Jenna, shows up. Is that what you're going
to
get to?
Okay, sure. Let's get to that. guys, Jenna has invaded paradise because of the aliens. Aliens invade.
Mm.
That was the words that I wrote.
It didn't land.
Yeah, Jordan is smitten. Was that another?
Yeah, that was another one.
Thanks for the backup, man.
Landing.
So, Jordan is absolutely smitten. He's absolutely smitten by her. I don't remember who it was. One of the untouchables or forgettables says, put your eyes back in your head, buddy. You remember who that was?
I think that was Nisha telling some horror story from her nursing.
Skinny black.
Okay.
You completely misread that situation.
All righty. Jordan and Becca have a little chat, and boy, what a chat it is. Pat, we have a clip.
You have really pretty eyes.
Thank
you're
you
like,
too.
Whoa.
Yeah. Like looking at myself here, it's like a girl version of me. But
yeah. I know, that's what I was thinking when I saw you. I was like, oh, that's guy version of me. Yeah. I was like, yeah.
Yeah, you're cute. Yeah. The way you clap your hands when you laugh, like that's my eyes do that when I laugh. Like they do it for me. So it's like, yeah. You seem really outgoing. So
yeah,
I like that.
Part. Yeah.
Yeah, we could probably cause some trouble.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah, yeah,
just burn the place down.
I know.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah.
I mean, this is 2 7-year-olds talking to each other.
All right, I don't know what point this was in the date, if they're riding horses at this point or on the beach or whatever. He
Before
is
that.
Way more normal when he feels comfortable or like got a chick into him or something. Like he seems more normal here.
Is there
no?
anything normal about saying when I look at you, I feel like I'm looking at myself?
I could see Vince Vaughn saying those lines, maybe.
Right.
It's almost like he went to Vince Vaughn's school of, like, trying to be cool with a chick or something.
No.
And to be honest, it's kind of accurate. I mean, they are kind of, like, they're just both very bizarre and outgoing.
Yeah, I guess.
it comes out in different.
Listen, I'm being a condescending asshole to him right now, as I am to a lot of people on this show, and for that I apologize. But I love these two.
Yeah.
And may I state, the fact that he does not have just zero chicks, but two chicks right now means the world is ending. I mean, this is an insane thing. Would we ever have called a world where evil Ben Stiller has game on this island, a piece of shit, and this and Jordan has two chicks vying for his love?
And John, but we're getting ahead of ourselves. Hey, guys.
Oh, you brought up John? Oh, we'll get to him later.
Sounds Native American.
I know. Pat, thank you. Jordan said that he's subscribing to whatever Jenna's on. And Pat, you posited that this was pills, correct?
Well, you know, last season, Corinne Olympias, that piece of shit drunk whore, she said that the reason she forgot that she was, the reason she thought that she was raped was on the fact that she brought pills in her suitcase and took them, and then that's why she blacked out.
Mm-hmm.
So no more pills on the island. They go through your suitcases. That being said,
okay,
Jenna's probably on pills.
I posited that she use them as a suppository.
Got it.
Oh, nice. That's when you put it up your bum.
Yeah.
Right.
And there's a little wordplay there.
Okie dokes. Guys, I love how brutal this show is sometimes. While they're having this quote-unquote chat, it's intercut with these sad, sad things that Annalise is saying. I don't remember or care about exactly what she said, but it was just more insane stuff. Like, I can't wait to spend the rest of my life with Jordan and
talking about kids, dude.
Stuff like that. Guys, let's talk about horsies. Jordan and Jenna trot down this this little trail, and one of the horses just starts going crazy and ripping plants out of the ground. And Jordan yells something, which I love. He's just like, is this a thing? This is a thing?
I think this is up there with that Muppet bicycle ride as some romantic duos on mobile things.
Okay. Hey.
It's late.
Hey, I just want to say they're still just brutally cutting in these Annalise clips. They found like five of them. Waited on him, sat on him, and then, you know, contrasted them with the love and budding romance of Jenna and Jordan.
She has just had a rough go on both seasons she was on. On Ari's season, she came in with that mask. It didn't play. It was very weird. She had all the trauma, obviously. That was obvious. Then, at the end, she tried to get a kiss from Ari. And Ari, for Christ's sake, the kissing bandit, wouldn't kiss her.
Yeah.
So she's had a rough ride.
Nick, not to go back too far in the past, but if my memory serves me correctly, was this the flight up to Napa? Was this his date in the winery? No?
No.
The other dumb blonde that's homely?
I don't even know where that one is.
I don't think she didn't get a date even. It was at a cocktail party. She was just begging for
a kiss. Then why the fuck is she here?
I have no idea, but she needs to just euthanize this part of her life.
I was thinking about this a lot, some of the casting choices as we were watching it tonight. I feel like they picked some of the most desperate women who are literally like trying to find a relationship, because you got like single mother Chelsea, Annalise,
Caroline,
very sad.
Jubilee.
Nick,
don't even get me started on the casting here, because I'm gonna go off on a rant here. What the fuck, Bachelor people? You got a treasure trove of losers that still want to be think they're gonna be fucking relevant. We got fucking people that weren't even on the fucking show. We got Canadian Kevin fucking here. Last time I looked at a trailer, Benoit, that piece of shit here. We got Yuki to entertain us. Was Yuki even on the fucking show? She's sitting behind the bar. She didn't entertain us at all.
No.
What the fuck? Who's Jubilee? Who's Angela? Get some of the hotter chicks that have been here. Get some former Bachelorettes. I'm sure they're not not doing anything to have them show up here.
Wow.
We've actually had like runner-up people show up on this show before. Maybe they're starting to realize it makes the show makes you look like a piece of shit.
Benoit?
Yeah, and the Canadian Benoit, who was in love with that other person. I don't want to get into it because Winter Games was a blemish.
I disagree. Okay, I had a fantastic time.
Just stop. You were right. He did really set you off, and you went on quite the rant there. We need to somehow steer this horse back on track.
I loved Bachelor Winter Games so much. Let's take a look back at Nick's 4-4. Harp.
Don't.
So Jordan and Jenna, they hit it off. These two people drinking champagne. The vibes are flowing. They really like each other. Who would have seen this fucking coming? I mentioned this earlier, not to be fucking redundant, but here I go. Who would have fucking thought this gay dude would have two chicks chasing his ass? I'm perplexed.
Patrick, you said that he wasn't gay.
Oh, yeah, right. Straight. Obviously, he's a straight guy. He was grabbing her ass, putting her on the horse earlier.
Yeah.
That's a man. That's a straight man right there. A gay man would never touch a woman's ass that way. He was slowly trying to put his index finger a little too close to
a little tip trail.
Yep. Nick, you know what I'm talking about. Thank you.
What?
You know what I'm saying.
No.
All that straight
dudes. It's a popular term in hip hop.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Can I get to the really? I thought this was interesting.
Yeah, go ahead.
So Jordan shows back up to the group, and they just had an amazing date. And I hate Jordan for this, but I kind of like this. He has to then go over to Annalise and kind of let her know what's going down.
Right. Now, the beginning of this, and Pat, you tell me if we've got a clip or not.
We do. I'm not Pat.
No, you are certainly not Pat. And I asked Pat to tell me if we had a clip.
We got a clip, dude. Dude, we got a clip of this. Can I play the clip?
Yeah, go for it.
I want to say this. Today's date was fantastic. The romantic connection is there. I spent an awful lot more time with Jenna than I have ever spent with you. It was insane. Our date was fantastic, right? But today, what happened on that beach, the romantic connection there, it just doesn't happen. Never. Like.
Way to pile on, dude. I mean, I kind of felt like this was unnecessary. Can I do a reenactment of this? Hey, look, I had a great time. I mean, it was really amazing. I mean, she seriously, I was f***ing her from behind, and she turned around and said, the only thing that would make this better is if you clone me, and my clone was eating your. I mean, seriously, this was a great date.
Yeah.
That's the kind of piling on that he just did there.
You're going to make me bleep again.
No.
You're going to make me bleep again when I edit the podcast.
I did not swear, dude. I did not swear at all.
Okay.
I think you should bleep it.
Yeah.
And I love bleeps for comedic value. I sometimes think they add to...
Right, they make it funnier.
Yeah. Leaves a little mystery.
But luckily, Pat provides a... plenty of canvas for those bleeps.
Gentlemen, right or wrong move of Jordan to let Annalise know what time it is?
I think you're kind of focused on the top part of this this conversation, which was, I agree, a little bit harsh, although honest. But it's what he says at the end of this conversation that is the most excruciating.
Well, Patrick asked what we thought of him just laying it down black and white like that.
Yes.
I think his example he gave, though, in the crassest way possible, and
right.
But it really got the point across. It was too graphic. You could have said that more succinct and not twisted the knife, so to speak.
Gosh, that's actually pretty brilliant. In a Bukowski-like manner, Patrick... mirrored the gratuity of what he said to Annalise with his filthy, filthy example.
I saw a barfly.
One of these references is going to land one day for me. Pat, do you have the back half of this conversation?
Absolutely, sir.
It's going to be hard for me to catch us up to what happened today. It's going to be extremely hard just because it was nuts.
I'm very perceptive, and I think that Jenna is going to go ahead and ride it out and, you know, see where things go with me. That's how I feel. And I told her that she was going to get my rose. So today's date was fantastic. Right now, I feel great about it. But tomorrow, if something happens and, you know, like, she decides that I'm not for her, you do absolutely deserve love. So just know that, like, I'm saving a place for you if something does happen. Because, like, I like you as a person.
Couple things. One, how could you be so dumb as to think that this series of words will work on a female human being? And two, how stupid do you have to be to buy this? He's literally telling you, you are my backup. But I don't want you to be discouraged by the fact that I don't want you unless I'm going to be kicked off this show. In which case, you deserve love.
Dumber things have been said on this show.
She did seem to buy it. And,
right?
And to you, Annalise, I say I have some oceanfront property in Glendale to sell you.
And for those of you that don't live in Southern California.
Yep. Thank you, Pat.
Glendale is a landlocked territory.
Yeah. Now, listen, Jordan has slain Annalise, essentially. And is killing it with Jenna, but in comes Chicken Man.
It's really half-ass. Cluck.
Could you do a better one? Pat?
I don't do chickens.
Okay, so
you did a chicken for a whole season.
That's a good point. Hey, I have to ask again. So, David, America hates the way that you are. Why are you still the way that you are?
By the way, if I went on a great date with Jenna, as Jordan did, I would not let her go, or not out of my sight. They cut to Jordan. He's walking along the ocean, off in his own thoughts. No fucking way. I'm going to leave time for Chicken Man, my adversary, to try and get in there and fuck with me. And that's exactly what Chicken Man did. And hold on. So Chicken Man sits down on the daybed, brings her a birthday cake with birthday candles, by the way. We skipped over that fucking thing. Mm-hmm. Sits down. They have a little conversation. And I don't know if Jenna's fucking with Jordan or just having a little fun play. I don't know. Or hedging her bets. Jordan sits down and yes, Chicken Man talks away, and Jordan seems visibly upset. And dare I say, he's so frazzled, we're not seeing the Jordan we saw on Becca's season, which he had the one-liners thrown out there. Boom, 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 boom. Which makes me think either he's completely frazzled when he's not in his own comfort zone, really likes this chick, or he canned all his fun stuff up front and he has no more good one-liners.
It's weird because you say that he should never let his rival, his adversary, anywhere near his queen, but he hasn't taken David seriously this entire time. I think the move is to just let him sit behind her and say strange things to her for a half an hour, but weirdly, he's like threatened by him.
I think the fact is David is a troll.
Right.
And though they don't usually have redeemable qualities, they are effective. And he's finally gotten underneath the skin of Jordan. He's at him every turn trying to fuck up what he's got going on, and I think he finally just got sick of it.
Yeah.
You know, he did some aggressive things here, Jordan. One was the cake that was given to her was on a plate, and he threw the plate. And then also
send it.
Keto. He sent it. Yes, he sent it. And he did something else that was really kind of out of character for Jordan as far as like male aggression. But he wasn't having it.
Well, he goes into a big diatribe about Mr. Rogers. which, again, I don't know anything about Mr. Rogers. I've never seen an episode. But you guys know the guy, right?
He's incredible. The first thing I would look up to get a little background, his testimony to get funding.
Okay, I've seen it.
Have you?
Yeah.
How were you not moved?
It's I'm not that passionate about children's television.
I wasn't either, but the way he warmed and grew that testimony leader's heart warmed my heart. So won't you be my neighbor?
Hey, Pat.
Let it play.
By the way, I know they're making a ton of documentaries about this.
It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood. A beautiful day for a neighbor.
He's got a terrible voice.
Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood. A neighborly day for a beauty. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you.
This is bad.
Let's make the most of this.
I will grant you it's hard not to believe this man isn't a pedophile.
Right.
But I'm telling you, he's on the up and up.
Would you be mine? Would you be mine? Would you be my neighbor?
Nick, they're making a lot of documentaries about this guy. He was actually like a priest or something for 30 years. Yes, there is nothing. We can find nothing in this man's past to show that he is a pedophile. This guy was actually a good human being, and I can't believe it.
I didn't know about that priest thing. So I'm telling you, the evidence is stacked against you, but he's clean.
I just don't think he's very good at singing. He seemed rushed and behind the beat the entire time there.
Wait till you get, like, the puppets involved and such. I'm not even saying, like, I remember watching it, but vaguely, but he's a very good influence, and,
Yeah, I mean, I guess, like, Mr. Rogers for me was Steve from Blue's Clues, and he was fired for heroin use or something like that. Maybe he passed.
Another thing to look up, when he's talking about, he's trying to console sad children, he's like, when a tragedy happens, look to the people who are doing the helping.
Okay, like Chef Jose Andres in Puerto Rico.
That seems like a loose analogy.
No. I think it's pretty spot on. Okay. So, hey, can we get back to this here television show?
Sure.
But before we do, let's take a quick break for some Apple Podcasts ratings and reviews.
It does not sound good. Let's go back. Patrick has refused to adopt it. So, anyways, harp.
Hey, Pat.
Yes, Devin.
How are you, sir?
Doing great, sir.
What's going on in the iTunes ratings and reviews?
Last year was our first one-star review, so we're marking the anniversary of our first one-star review. And, you know, we always have to see where we're at now. Are we in the same place as we were last year? All right, so here's that one-star review.
I'm excited to find out.
I would ask the audience if they agree with this. this was left on September 1st by Rachel 6634.
1 year anniversary.
Well, close to it anyway. Couldn't get through any of it. One star. There are so many funny ways to go about making fun of these shows / contestants. Not sure why their go-to jokes are sexist and demeaning. Try the Bachelor pod. Well, Rachel, we're still doing what we're doing over here, and hopefully you're dead or I don't know, died of a drug overdose, because you're a miserable fucking human being.
Dead or died of a drug overdose.
Well, one of those things. I was going to say dead, like maybe she just died of natural fucking causes or something. But anyway, you're a horrible person, but I'm sure you're still listening. Anyway, join the Facebook group. We're having a ball over there.
More like Rachel 666.
So, listen, I got to respect her because she did leave her name and told us exactly what she thought about our show. Okay, back to this here television program, Bachelor in Paradise. Oh, hey guys, Caroline shows up.
Gets a date card. Is that the thing when you show up, you get the date card?
I think for the most part, but not always.
So far, Colton, Jenna,
Tia,
Caroline,
Tia.
Yeah, she got the first, she was there.
First aid. Yeah, so that's the process, I guess.
Yeah, guys, poor thing is so nervous. I mean, she gets down there and everybody's there looking at her and she has to piss and she does not know what to do with herself. So she awkwardly walks around the entire property.
there was a lot of talk how Joe, grocery store Joe, was he kind of froze up when he was first on camera. Mm-hmm. But Carolyn was so camera shy, she made Joe the grocer look like Ryan Seacrest.
Right. He's totally not camera shy.
No, he is. But she's so far more camera shy that he still looks like a pro.
Oh, I was talking about Ryan Seacrest.
Oh, yeah. No, he is not camera shy.
He is not camera shy. She has to find an instant connection with somebody. That's what the card says. That's what she's got to do. She leaves Joe sitting there because she had to go take a shit, not a piss. And then she lands on young Jonathan.
Asian John.
Do you have that Dances with Wolves tune you want to play?
No, Dylan. What I do have here is a hot take.
Wow.
Caroline, my theory here is, and I don't want to come off racist or anything, but I'm pretty sure no chicks are really hot for Asian John. He's a safe bet. And I'm thinking Caroline has a boyfriend when she showed up to the beach.
I don't think so.
Mm-hmm, 100%.
I don't think so.
She mentioned how she was broken up with and like...
Well, that's kind of leaning that would, towards, that... you know, probably me on and off or something. Mm-hmm.
Can I give a really conspiratorial hot take?
Yeah, of course. I love conspiracies.
So, Caroline comes in. She's freaking can't even talk. She's so scared. Goes after low hanging fruit John.
Yep.
Hits it off.
Right.
They think she might be there a while. They throw in this wild card they got waiting there, Jubilee, and they're like, "Hey, you go in there. You sweep John off his feet. We need to get Caroline out of there. This was a huge mistake. She doesn't belong on television. Do your job."
Well, are you insinuating that they kept Jubilee in a cage?
No. I did not say that. I want this definitive known. I am saying she's an assassin sent there specifically break glass in case of emergency. Carolyn was a mistake. We must eliminate her.
Well, Jubilee...
She was in the military. It makes sense.
Listen, Jubilee does a damn fine job. She is the Terminator when it comes to Caroline's chances in this.
Hold on, but Jubilee has not showed up.
Yes, it's true. We're getting ahead of ourselves.
I didn't know when to make that analogy, and I didn't want us to skim past it.
So, he gets a...
date card!
Yes, he does. And what do? They go have...
They go on a date, dude.
Yeah, they go to a Mexican cantina, which, again, the music is a little off for...
What is the name of the YouTube video playing? What?
Winds of Spring.
Winds of Spring.
Winds of Spring. Yeah, so this is a Native American song.
No, dude. The YouTube description is 1 hour of Asian music instrumental.
Okay. All right.
It's got a flute, dude. It's got a pan flute. Asians, they love this.
To me, I mean, I can smell the sage burning. Okay, let's move on. They're at this Mexican cantina, and the animals are afoot. John gets a little Pavelka-y here. He has a little moment of aggression. He's talking to the camera. He's like, you know, I didn't think we'd be naming animals tonight.
Now, hold on. Set the stage. All right. So this has happened to
me. What are you talking about? They're at a Mexican cantina. They're having dinner.
Yeah. Hold on. That's not what he was referring to, you big dummy. He's trying to, like, bust out how fucking rich he is and how successful he is.
No.
Yes, he is, 100%. Be quiet.
Oh, my God.
You're so wrong.
Oh, my God.
She asks him what he does, and he goes, well, I got to tell you, I was early in on Venmo, and, you know, I do this. And then a dog walks up, and she goes, oh, what's your name? Name the dog. And he's like, And he's like, well, let me keep talking about how much money I make. And then a cat walks up, and she says, name the cat. Nick! Tell me, is that what happened?
No.
I don't think it is. I thought it was... I thought
absolutely not.
I thought he was trying to downplay what he did. He said, I'm just a lowly programmer.
And he has that conversation with Jubilee. With Caroline, he has this bullshit Bachelor conversation. Like, so what are you expecting to see here, to find here, to get here? Stuff like that. Bullshit like that. And she doesn't want to do it. So that's why they're naming things. And again, I'm scared of whoever ends up with him, because I fear that he's a very violent partner. Like Michael Jackson's father, but to a wife.
Getting back to Caroline again in her attention span, she is not into this dude by the fact that she's paying attention to the fucking pets.
Right.
Okay. So yeah. We all agree on that?
Absolutely. Safe bet, low hanging fruit. She wants to stay on this island. John is a good pick. Until Jubilee walks in.
Odd choice for this season of BIP, seeing as she's from four seasons back. She's from Ben's season. Ben Higgins.
Greatest Bachelor of all time.
We discussed this at the top of the episode. Wow. In your Rolodex of losers,
right,
that have nothing to do. I mean, call Chad, that meat-eating protein piece of shit steroid motherfucker.
Chad. You can't have Chad.
Okay, he's horrible. But what I'm saying is there's other people. Call Christian Bishop. Right. He'll show up.
Yeah, exactly.
JJ Lane.
Although Christian, if he walked onto the island, I'm sure people would be like, who the fuck is that guy?
Speaking of your favorite Bachelor of all time, Ben Higgins.
Yeah.
I think he's going to embarrass himself this season. In the preview, we've seen him in that mariachi.
Screaming, I'm not lovable.
I'm unlovable or something.
That was Ben Higgins?
Yeah, not looking
forward to that. I thought that was evil Ben Stiller.
No. It was Big Ben.
He's hanging by a thread.
Yes, he is, and it's really sad to see. Don't you feign fascination in this?
I think he is actually stunned. That was not Chris. You're okay? Stunned.
Yeah, no, I'm fine. I'm fine. I'm just
take a breath.
I'm just shocked by these losers.
Okay.
See, yeah. Genuine.
Hey, so Jubilee walks in, and now Nick, you were a little blown away, weren't you?
I was flabbergasted.
Yeah, pretty lady.
Yes.
Great ass.
Ew.
No, she does.
She does.
Very nice. But she talks to...
Badonka donk.
She talks to every single guy like it's a fucking job interview. She's very intense. So what's your time been like? Are you with anybody?
Militaristic.
Very, yeah. It's like,
if you will.
It's like she calls 2 o'clock 1400.
Yeah, she would definitely do that.
Yeah, she absolutely would. After she's done interrogating the entire island, she picks John to go on a wonderful ziplining date.
I found it no coincidence that they were ziplining through the jungle and John was stricken with jungle fever.
We're saying some dicey stuff tonight, huh?
Is jungle fever that bad?
I think it's acceptable.
Okay. All right. Well, democracy. Hey, so I thought they were cute. They kind of hit it off, and we finally get a confirmation. He is very rich.
Yes. He humble brags quite a bit.
Yep.
I want to see your portfolio, though, dude.
Yeah, he's very defensive about how much money he makes. He started early with the roommates from college, at which we surmised.
I've seen Silicon Valley.
We don't live in the valley, but everything's in equity. Everything's in equity back up in those hills.
And what's that mean?
He's saying...
No, I know what it means. It means nothing. Oh, I got equity in this company.
They give him 2% of Venmo. Venmo's Venmo now, you dummy. He's got gold diggers. He's swatting away left and right. He's already got his walls built up because he has hundreds of billions of dollars.
I think that's a little hyperbole, but...
Why is he having this music play behind him if he's worth that much money?
Why is he having this music play behind him?
I think it's a fair question, sir.
Okie dokes. Let's get back to the island, which is more entertaining than Jubilee and John.
Meanwhile, that's my new segment. Crazy Crystal and Kenny.
I love that. Meanwhile.
I do, too. I love new segments, and this one's fun because there's always these interjections.
He's still sweating. That gross piece of shit. Jesus Christ. Yeah. Boy. But can I set the stage? He sets up a date for them. He lays out four candles in a fucking blanket and thinks this is a date. Boy, right. I wish my wife would let me get away with that one.
So he's very, very confident, which is confusing. And he says that he's going to take this to a new level, or the next level with Crystal. It's not the next level. It's a different level in that she breaks up with him.
He's used to professional wrestling, but sorry, Kenny, this ain't scripted. Almost, but it's not scripted.
Nice. She says she wants to explore all possibilities, I believe.
Yeah, she just laughs at him for a while and then breaks up with him.
I believe as we were watching the show off mic, of course, Dylan, sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah, no, of course.
I believe one of us said it was in May. That was pretty daring for her to do this because she had a safe week or not a safe week. She needed his fucking rose.
Yeah. The men had the power this week. But she was so confident, she blew off a suitor she had in the bag.
Well, I think she is founded in that confidence. I think she's going to be absolutely fine.
Super founded.
Does that make sense?
Founded? Yeah, I think so.
Okay. She says what I have deemed and identified as the worst thing you could hear from somebody you're interested in on this island. If somebody says, go do your thing, I don't care, that's the last nail in the coffin. That's the silver bullet. It's not going to work. Hey, do you guys want to really quickly help me out with this rat and cheese thing? Because I don't understand it.
Three black guys talking about cheese. Very confusing.
How drunk are you? I think it was just Eric and Kenny, wasn't it?
Yeah. Sorry. I was thinking about when I think about cheese, I always think about three layers or something. I'm sorry. I was
three blind mice.
Three layers.
I don't know. They were talking about cheese. They were using metaphors that were going fucking sideways in my brain.
The conversation was very cheesy.
Okay, so none of us really grasped it. Guys, let's talk about Chris and Tia.
Evil Ben and Tia.
He makes himself look pretty crummy here, doesn't he?
Well, hold on. He gets ratted out. Oh, another
he doesn't get ratted out.
Yes,
yet.
He does.
He's done nothing yet, except tell Tia, trust me, you're the only person for me on this island. Trust me. Then he sits down with crazy Crystal.
Because Crystal goes on the attack after breaking Kenny's heart.
Yeah. Yeah. She's like a male penguin who like leaves the child, and he's like, well, gotta scuttle off, dive 30 feet into ice cold water, get slammed against the shore of another land, catch some fish, and go back. Fuck.
Well, Crystal has just decided that Chris is her new upgrade. She's like, this is it. I've decided I'm going to get the rose from him.
Right.
Like, she's that confident. He thinks he's just smooth as shit because he pulls out this line that I've never kissed a blonde before. It was corny and just get it over with. She was like, yeah, okay, let's do this.
Yeah.
And he thinks he needed that line to pull it off.
Although she still was, like, visibly not into him at all, because how could you look at that thin, thin hairline in the front and all the things he's saying and be into him. You know what I mean? And while the conversation between him and Tia made him look really, really bad, also, you mentioned it, the lie that he told about the first blonde and also the way that his mouth is when he kisses people, he's so revolting.
And then they make out for a while.
And then they make out for a while.
Next morning. Meanwhile. Then.
Mm-hmm. Colton sits down with Kevin. And hears that Chris has been tying tongues with Crystal.
A little tonsil hockey. A little lip locking.
Even
the thought that someone could be hurting Tia for a second fucking pisses him. It cheeses him off.
Ooh, callback.
Callback. Because he is, after all,
her ex, I guess.
Yeah, no, he really cares about her. He really, really cares about her. And this makes him kind of look good because he's consoling her, and at least he's not a filthy fucking liar like Chris. Colton's been fairly honest about this entire thing. He's like, you're not the only one for me. I'm going to explore everything.
All right, let me throw this out there. I watch Vanderpump Rules against my will with my wife.
Mm-hmm.
The acting here between Tia and Colton during this exchange where she's like, oh, you're here to help me? It reminds me of all the bad acting I see on Vanderpump Rules.
Right.
This is a scene they're doing, and I hate it. I hate this part of BIP. This is why I said at the start of this show, the worst thing about this season of BIP is Tia and Colton. We need to get these two fools off the island. I want them to fall in love, let a rock hit them in the fucking head, die, drown in the ocean. I don't give a fucking flying fuck.
A rock hits both of them in the head?
They're
and
on the
they
edge of a fucking mountain. I don't
ocean.
Care. They're horrible. I hate it. Everything is forced with them. I like watching Kenny because Kenny's here. He's like trying to get laid or something.
Stop it.
I know they're... all right. Anyway.
Kenny.
Maybe they could die from like a horrible staph infection.
Why? How come?
I don't know. That sounds has always sounded pretty painful, but also realistic.
Hold on. Do you believe for one goddamn second that Tia and Colton have anything that they care about with each other?
No.
Okay. So then it's all for naught. Get out. Get the fuck out of here.
Listen, I'm with you. I'm surprised you didn't say hot take because I think that's a beautiful way to look at this. This is a scene. Curtain up.
Hey, we haven't said it for a while, but... he's known all over that San Fernando Valley for the mics, the lights, the tears, and the fears.
That's why we joined up with this guy to do this here podcast.
Thanks, guys.
Okay. Chris and Jordan talking about a little bit of a meal plan. We've got apps, we've got supper, and we've got zerts. They are talking about, and I think bubbly before the appetizers actually get there as well. A four-course, even though champagne isn't a course, meal of women. This is disgusting coming from these two. You've used the word a few times tonight. Losers. These guys are fucking losers. I love Jordan, but you're not a male model. You're doughy, and you're not that attractive. Chris, you're bona fide ugly.
And a scumbag. I couldn't hang out with this guy. Like, I couldn't even pretend it. If I, like, teamed up with this guy at a bar and he's like, hey, let's get some girls tonight. Because I used to have that happen to me back in my day. Like, hey, man, let's wingman it out or something like that. I would look at him. I'd take two eyes at him and I'd be like, you, my friend, are a scumbag. Well, I will not try and get pussy with you. I will not. You will tear my cachet down. You get out of here. You go find another place to live. And it's a whole... in the ground because you're a snake. And Dylan, you know where snakes sleep? Outside.
Nick, you brought up this exact point that Pat is trying to make here
so eloquently.
Yeah, so you said tarnish cachet by just being around him, and you said the only bad thing about Jordan is that he's friends with Evil Ben Stiller.
Exactly. Like you mentioned, he was doughy. He could lose that quick if he's got a shoot coming up. Being friends with Chris is a black... I like to believe there's a little bit of optimist in me that wants to think he's just kind of gassing Chris up to get him to say stupid shit.
Yeah.
He's just like, oh, yeah, one, two, three, four.
Feeding
making
him shots of fireball.
Yeah, feeding him verbal shots of fireball.
Yeah. Hey... I wanted to ask you guys before we go, who do you hate more, David or Evil Ben Stiller?
Cliffhanger. I know that's not good pod, but that is a thinker. I'm going to say David.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to say evil Ben Stiller because David, I could literally put my penis in his mouth and say swallow. And he would do what I tell him.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're going to have to put it to the baby birds as well because I'm split right down the middle. I can't make a call. They're both so horrific. Some of the worst people ever grace this stage. Some of the worst.
I love me a good poll, and I love one that's going to like really split the audience.
Yeah.
Fireworks in that comment section of that poll.
Yeah,
I want.
Get ready for a freaking lightning rod. Hey, guys. Talk about a cliffhanger. It's not quite will the Goose Gang kill Colton.
We talk about it like they're never going to... Like, it's past that the Goose Gang might kill Colton, but I find that the Goose Gang is extremely unpredictable and could possibly kill Colton at any time.
It's a super good point. But our cliffhanger is Tia approaching two members of the Goose Gang, the only two left, as Nikki Slick was terminated on the first episode. We will find out what she says to him next week. As we mentioned, it's rather late, and we must be going.
Arizona Missions. I'm not like.
Oh my goodness. It's time for a fan favorite segment, although very confusing to the fans. A fan favorite segment, Arizona Missions.
This week's Arizona Missions. I think you guys got it down now, but one more time. It's places where we erred and things we omitted.
Thank you.
I know the fans on the social media have just been going crazy because we haven't done it in a while, but here it finally is. It's going to be a quick one again this week. Omitting, of course, the fact that we've omitted Arizona Omissions the last couple weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
No, it's not right of us.
Oh, yeah, it's not right of us at all. But omitting that fact, of course, this week there's only one you mentioned earlier.
I have one after you.
This isn't your segment.
It's not your segment, but I'm curious. You go first. Mine's the finale.
All right. So last week on the episode, I had said that Tia not showing up on the island and just DMing Colton and not having us go through all this bullshit was a comparison to episode 4, Star Wars A New Hope. Could have all been avoided had the droids in their pod been shot down by the Star Destroyer. And I said that 8 movies would not have been made if that had happened. In fact, there were 3 prequels, which would mean that only 5 movies would be skipped over had they done that. So I am very sorry. Thank you, baby birds.
Wow.
Here's another one. It was a huge error giving Pat that platform. But one error from earlier this episode.
This is the finale?
Yeah, this is the finale. You mentioned when I was taking notes in Microsoft Word, my cursor was just sitting there. When I take notes, I use Google Sheets. That was this week's Errors and Omissions.
Thank you so much for listening. We will be back next week to cover 4 more hours of Bachelor in Paradise. Hey, guys, remember to join us on Facebook in the, can we call it the Nest? Am I doing that for the first time?
I like it. Let's do it.
It's our Facebook group with our lovely fan base called the Baby Birds. Join us there, facebook.com/group/.
We should go live and we'll call it the Nest Cam.
Facebook.com/group/.
Another Bachelor Podcast.
And on Instagram, we are at...
Another Bachelor Podcast.
And thank God we're dropping this. Hop in the iTunes ratings and reviews. Leave 5 stars so that Pat does not get upset. If you're going to leave 1, tell us who you are. Guys, we're going to see you next week. Until then, I'm Dylan saying goodbye. Nick, say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Pat, say goodbye.
Bye, guys.